Welcome to our latest edition of TNT Tuesday Night Theology.
What's good, my people?
I am Pastor Joe with the great Michael LeMelle Sr. And we have just been inundated with so much encouragement. God is a God of His Word.
Last week,
we talked about the fact that He's able to do exceeding abundantly above
exceeding.
All
exceeding. You can see it pop up. Exceeding.
Exceeding. And from last week to this week, He did just that. The support has been amazing. Testimonies even have come to us.
Even just a few minutes ago.
Exactly. Just had one just a few minutes ago. And we're going to keep it going. Mm-hmm. As long as you keep responding, we're going to keep coming at you.
Amen.
And we want you to do what you've been doing. Like, share, tag, call. If we make you mad, we want to hear that. If we make you happy,
bring the smoke.
We want to hear that. But this is what we do.
We know that there are people who are just watching, and that is quite all right. If you don't respond, we want that also. And we want you to have it in your mind what we're talking about and a discussion about it, even if it's just with yourself and in a moment of introspection. But picking up this word and getting into it, even if it's only to contradict what we're saying, we welcome that.
Absolutely.
Amen.
Absolutely.
Please.
Absolutely. The Bible talks about God says in Isaiah, come let us reason together.
Reason.
And that's a principle that we are standing on, that if you have something that you want to say, bring it to us and we'll be glad to discuss it. And it seems like the discussion today has landed us in this somewhat controversial idea.
Somewhat.
That our God is a jealous God.
Jealous God.
A jealous.
Jealous God. when we say the word jealous, we are often, we defer to what we know. As in most cases, we're human. So I have a thing that I like to say, start with what you know. And we know that the word jealous has been programmed into us with having a negative connotation.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
And so our quandary is, how do we apply our negative perspective on a positive God?
That's good.
How do we confine Him or relegate Him to the parameters that our mind has set for an all-knowing, all-wise, omnipotent, omniscient creator?
Exactly.
I think that would be shame on us, actually, to try to put Him in the parameters of this square or rectangle, and He is all. He's exceeding abundantly. So yeah, jealous. I'm gonna, Joe, talk to them for a second while I look up the definition of jealous. What is that?
Right. Everything that he's just said is such a perfect kind of introduction, because anytime we're discussing God, first of all, we have to try to put it in language that we're able to understand and comprehend.
Can I make an insert? Mm-hmm. Discussing God, not debating.
Right. Yes. Discussing.
I just had to say it. Right. Pastor said it.
Exactly.
We're not debating.
Right. This is theology. It's the study of God. We're trying to understand Him better. Right.
Yes. So, and His word.
Exactly. So what happens is we have to try to put it in language oftentimes that we're able to understand, when He really exists outside of our understanding of language. And so things get broken down really into our childlike understanding of something, of someone that's way beyond it. And so the idea of jealousy, like you said, it takes on a very negative connotation. I was just reading over in Paul's writing. He absolutely talks about that people that function with jealousies shall not inherit the kingdom of God.
In the book.
So how does God then say, first of all, that I am jealous and that I'm a jealous God if this is a very negative negative thing?
Right. And in our discussions that we have, in our presentations, one of the things that Pastor said last week and that we want to continue to reiterate is that we are truth seekers. We are agents of truth. Right. And as we all should be, we should obligate ourselves to be that. And the Greek word for that is zeteo. So we are zetetic in nature. Mm-hmm. Truth seekers.
Wow.
So if that is true, if that part is true, then we are obligated to press constantly toward the truth,
absolutely,
which pressing toward God. He is the way, the truth. Mm-hmm. And see how that works? It's very simple. We were talking about this earlier. Everything about the Creator and Him and His essence is very simple. Now, this can be, people will try to debate me on this, but I will tell you that you are simple, and that's not negative. Joe, Pastor Joe, is simple. I am simple. We are simple in our makeup. We are also simultaneously complex, but there's a difference between complex and complicated.
Talk good. Yes, sir.
Nothing about God is complicated.
Right.
We complicate things.
Right.
Because of our simple nature. Oh, Lord, have mercy. This is, it's just get ready to get good for me.
Yep.
So you are simple. It's just like saying you are ignorant. That is not a negative word. I teach my students that. It is okay to be ignorant.
Exactly.
Because it simply means not knowing.
Exactly. Just don't know.
Now, the thing is to not remain ignorant.
Exactly. Exactly.
So in this series, in this show, people have been calling the show or an event, when we are truth seekers and we do not want to remain ignorant. We don't want to remain ignorant. And exactly. We definitely have a heart for you all to not remain ignorant.
Exactly.
Which means simply, again, not knowing.
Exactly.
In these discussions, we'll be dealing with the etymology of words frequently because we're trying to get to the truth of a thing.
Exactly.
The root of a thing.
Exactly.
The simplicity of a thing.
Of a thing.
Amen, somebody.
Talk.
Somebody type simple in the comments. You know what I mean? Simple.
Simple.
Just simple.
Right.
Simple. So don't forget that. God is not complicated. Nothing about Him is complicated.
That's right.
Some things are complex, which is a different matter. Complicated? No. Complex? Yes.
Exactly. Exactly. And what you said about truth, I've been mulling over this. I was kind of trying to wait to get to that. And I might just do that. I'm going to put my pause.
Okay.
Talk to us a little bit about.
Brother, you can get it anytime.
I'm going to pause.
I think we'll do a whole segment on truth.
We're going to have to.
Because some people have been charging. Even so, there were some people who listened to us and have been accosted, for a better word, lack of a better word, or bullied because they are excited about the truth that we ignited in them and shared with them. And we should all, again, be truth seekers, and we don't stand for bullying.
Oh, no.
We don't sit for it. We don't lay down for it. We don't stand for it.
No.
So if you are bullying someone, and particularly about the things we are saying, shame on you, because we're right here. Our shoulders are broad enough to accept that weight of that.
Amen.
And so feel free. We easily found.
Exactly. We're right here.
We're waiting on you.
Exactly. We are right here.
We are right here. So, yeah, truth. Maybe let's put a mind that we might do that.
Yeah, we do.
I have a couple of things about truth myself. So let's look at this. Jealous. Jealous. It's an adjective.
Mm-hmm.
Feeling or showing envy of someone or their achievements and advantages. And the example sentence is, he grew jealous of her success.
Right.
Oh, that's good too.
Mm-hmm.
Feeling or showing envy, that's an important word, of someone or their achievements and advantages. The second input is feeling or showing suspicion of someone's unfaithfulness in a relationship, mm-hmm, like a jealous boyfriend or a jealous girlfriend.
Right.
The third sub is fiercely protective. Oh, my.
Mm.
And this is third down the line, though. Fiercely protective or vigilant of one's rights or possessions. And it says Howard is still a little jealous of his authority. He's protective of it.
Exactly.
He's vigilant for it.
Exactly.
It's interesting that we use Howard in the thing.
Right.
So jealous. Feeling or showing envy of someone or their achievements and advantages. Jealous. That is what our understanding of it is. Feeling or showing envy. So my question is simply this. How could an all-wise, all-knowing, pinnacle God, an apex creator, what we say often the Alpha and the Omega.
Yes, sir.
The consistent one. The immaculate one. How could or why would this particular God have anything to be envious about? Why would he be envious to anyone or anything else? Why?
Right. Which you kind of answered the question. Because he's not.
Because he's not. That's what.
He's simply not.
Simply.
And when God speaks about himself as jealous, it's not that he is scared or envious of other people.
Say it.
There is an entirely different connotation and understanding that the text presents to us.
Yes.
And oftentimes what I've encountered, and one of the reasons why we're doing this, is people have said to me, why would you serve a jealous
they
God?
They have said it directly, haven't they, preacher?
Directly to me. And I'm hoping that by the end of this conversation, the question will be, why would you not serve a jealous God?
Sorry, got to stay in camera. Lord have mercy. What?
Why would you not?
I'm going to have a keyboard up here. Why would you not?
If you're serving a God that's not jealous, hopefully by the end of this discussion, we will have changed your mind.
You just blessed me so good. Why would you not?
Why would you not?
Let me pull up these scriptures. So we're looking at Exodus, what is that? 34.
Exodus 34. The first time I think it comes to Exodus 20, but Exodus 34 is when he specifically, I believe, says, my name is jealous, right?
My name, that's the part I wanted to deal with. Exodus 34 and 14, let's look at that. For thou shalt worship no other God. This is lowercase g.
Lowercase.
For the Lord, capital L, capital, all the letters are capital.
All capital, right.
For the Lord, whose name is jealous, is a jealous God. Whose name is jealous, capital J, is a lowercase jealous God. Those descriptives are very important as well, I believe.
Absolutely.
So, yes, Exodus 34 and 14. For thou shalt worship no other God, for the Lord whose name is jealous is a jealous God. Would you like to expound, preacher?
Well, it's interesting because there's a few ways that you could look at it.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm going to take it another way.
Yeah, all right.
And let's think about the idea and the concept of God being jealous from our standpoint.
Our perspective, yes.
That,
yes.
I don't want you to deal with that guy because I want you to only deal with me.
Only deal with me.
Let's say that was it. Well, if you're going to serve God, then that presupposes that he is almighty. It presupposes that he is all-powerful. It presupposes that there could be little gods, but he's the guy or the entity that says, I'm chief.
That part.
And so if you're serving God Almighty, it is absolutely his right to say, you don't get to serve nobody else but me.
But me. And I created you.
Exactly. I created you. And I had to create everything else. So it's absolutely my right to say, if you're going to worship anything, it's got to be me. I can't have you serving anybody else outside of me because of who I am. I have a character and a nature that demands complete servitude to me. And when you step outside of that, it's an insult to me and what I've done to you and for you. Specifically, when you look at the children of Israel to whom this command first came to, they're coming out of Egypt. It's a polytheistic society. The whole idea of their deliverance was God was challenging the gods that they served. Pharaoh was supposed to be a god. He was supposed to be a god of light. And at every single part of the plague, God was showing, whatever God level you think you are, I'm just higher.
Exceeding.
I'm bigger. I'm bad. You think the Nile is God? I will smack it and turn it into blood. You think he's light? I'll put you in darkness. You think that there's fertility gods? I'll shut it all down. You think that the Pharaoh, the firstborn, means something? I'll kill them all. Because you got to let my people go. These are my people.
My people.
That are going to serve me. And I'm not going to allow you carrying my name to carry the name of somebody else.
Now, let me ask you this, preacher, because this has come up to me several times. That God of the Old Testament is a mean son of a gun.
Hey, that's what they say.
They say that. We might have to do a segment on that.
We probably are going to have to.
Especially with you presenting like that. That's good what you're saying. That makes sense to me.
Right. But there seems to be a dichotomy.
Mm-hmm.
But
right.
You also have to understand kind of time. And see, we're getting all into it.
Right. That's good.
But anytime you're establishing something,
mm-hmm.
things, anything that's being birthed, my daddy says it all the time, is messy. And you've got to go through the process of coming in to what it is that you're supposed to come into. So when we're looking at this, particularly as it comes to Moses as one of the Ten Commandments,
right.
God is being very specific that I'm the God that you need to serve. And even if that was where it ended, for me, that's good enough. And it makes, in my opinion, perfect sense. Why would you serve a God that's cool with you serving other gods? That doesn't make any sense. Because if he's cool with it, by definition, that suggests he's inferior. You have to serve a superior. The supreme being cannot, in my opinion, by his nature, allow you comfortability with serving things that are lesser than him. Right? So even if it ended there, we could close the book, close it down right now. But I'm going to pass the ball to you because I know that that's not even where it is. Right?
Wow.
Right?
You just exploded that whole thing, though, preacher. Like, wow. So look, let's look at this. This is what I was examining, and we'll put some things on the screen.
Right.
And links are going to be
in the comments.
Yes. In the description, you'll see the links.
Yep.
So we need to look at a few words to understand the etymology of this word jealous. In ancient Hebrew, when the text was written and they wrote these words, which were inspired by the Creator, and said in that Exodus 34 and 14, thou shalt worship no other God, for the Lord, whose name is jealous, is a jealous God. They combine some words like we do, and we make contractions and use different words to make another word. And the first word or letter, first letter of this word, because there were symbols in ancient Hebrew,
right.
is Nun. The name of it is Nun. And the transliteration for this is the letter N. It is N that we have. And the picture of it is a seed, just like a sperm cell traveling, or a seed from a plant that is traveling. It's a seed. That's what the picture looks like. You'll see it on the screen. And the meaning is, a seed is the beginning of new life, which came from the parent plant. This cycle will continue for generation after generation. And the definition simply is a continuation of life from a seed. Now, if the Creator is the Creator that he is, the seed comes from
the Creator.
The Creator.
Right.
Simple.
Easy.
The second letter in this conjunction, and as we're compiling this jealous understanding, is kuf. All right, in ancient Hebrew, that's Q-U-P-H, kuf. And its transliteration is the letter Q that we have today for your understanding now. The picture of it will be similar to a rising and or a setting sun. So you would have the horizon going straight across a flat plane.
Stop <messing. laughs>
A flat plane, if you will, the horizon, a horizontal line, and then the sun breaking that, the breaking of day or the conclusion of a day, with the sun moving and setting or rising across the horizon. So it would simply be like a circle with a line going through it, basically. And then this had grew into having different variations, same letter, but different variations. And it turned into what we have today as the letter Q, the capital letter and the lowercase letter Q. The meaning is, when the sun sets, the light is gathered to the sun. When the sun rises, the darkness is gathered at the opposite horizon of the sun. The rising and setting of the sun is also seen as a circling of the earth. Okay. The definition is the circling sun, which causes the gathering of light and darkness. That's kuf. The first one is the seed. That's nun. The second one letter is kuf. All right. The letter Q. Now, the parent root of this word jealous is putting the seed and the sun together. All right.
Right.
That is QN, all right, QN. It is a gathering for the seeds. Now, we know over in Ecclesiastes, they tell us there's a time for everything, a season for it.
That's right.
And there's a time to plant the seed, and there's a time to harvest the seed. You consummate with your spouse, and then 9 months later, the seed harvest is coming.
Exactly.
No matter how you look at it, it's coming.
It's coming, right.
If we plant peanuts, we're not going to get soybeans.
That's right.
When harvest comes, peanuts are coming up.
Exactly.
So we want to be clear of that. The parent root is a gathering for the seed. That's QN. And it is both the seed and the Q together, the rising and setting of the sun. And the meaning is this. Before a bird lays her eggs, she goes around acquiring and gathering materials to build her nest. That's simple enough. The definition is the gathering of materials for the building of a nest for the seeds or for the eggs. All right? And so we can see that a bird would gather things to build a nest, like God made this earth. He made the nest for us, and we are in this nest.
Exactly.
And he put it all together. In the beginning, God created, Genesis 1:1, the heavens and the earth.
Yes.
And he gathered the things and put them together. The child root for this ancient Hebrew word is ka-ne'eh, all right? And the meaning of that is to build a nest. Creator God.
Boom.
He is a creator. This child root is a nest builder, one who builds a nest, like I said, such as a bird. Also, God, as in Genesis 14:19, God most high creator, Kane, of sky and earth. I mean, that's simple.
It's real simple.
The English word create is an abstract word and a foreign concept to the Hebrews. The way we have it now. And as the pastor was saying, we have to examine what was going on when this was happening.
Right.
You made some excellent points about Pharaoh and Egypt. My God. And right. So we have to examine what was happening when this was exposed or created or given to us. Genesis 14:19 says, God most high creator, and the Hebrew word for that is kaneh, creator, kaneh, of sky and earth. And since it's foreign, we have to look at the matters surrounding that, why it is. While we see God as one who makes something from nothing, which means to create, the Hebrews saw God like a bird who goes about acquiring and gathering all the materials to build a nest. Ken, that is K-N, that I said earlier, the nest, which is the sky and the earth. The Hebrews saw man, us, as the children or the eggs. Very simple. Everything is very simple. They use simplicity.
Right.
And that God built the nest for the man or the eggs. Mm-hmm. All right. You can reference Numbers 24 and 2 to reference this. All right. I want to move along, but I'm going to have this on the screen and in the description.
Right.
Now, the other child roots, Kana, Kana. This is where we want to be, Kana, which means to protect. Now, this child root is to guard, often translated as jealous.
Jealous, that's it.
A bird watches over the eggs and young with jealousy.
Absolutely.
And will defend them from the enemy and prevent any other bird from entering the nest or any other imminent danger. Just as a bird watches over her eggs from predators, God also watches over his children in his nest, the earth, protecting them from predators who happen to be also in the earth. That's another thing.
Yeah, that's good.
He roams about seeking mm-hmm. to kill, steal, and destroy. That's all goes together. It just goes together. It's in there.
Right.
Yep. And protecting them from predators and other gods. So the definition we have now, putting these things together, the nest, the seed, the nest, and the building, protection, kana, kana. That's the Hebrew transliteration for these symbols, kana, and it means protection. Now we can reference picture that the Hebrews had of God in Exodus 34 and 14, which I just read. Do not worship any other god, for the Lord Yahweh, whose name is kana, or jealous, is a jealous kana god. Kana means what? Protector. He is that.
Right. He is protector.
Do and not worship any other god, for Yahweh, the Lord, whose name is protector.
Protector.
His name is protector.
Right. Right.
Is a protector god.
Boom.
Preaching. That's good. Go ahead and get some of that.
It's as good as it gets. I mean, everything that you said, when I'm listening to you, I feel like I could see what took place at the beginning.
Yes.
When God created a garden.
Yes.
It would be like a nest. Places man inside of the garden.
Yes.
Forms
the
him.
The seed. Yeah. Right,
and then says, I'm going to give you everything. I just need you to do this because this is going to keep you protected from the enemy.
Sir.
That is trying to get you outside of where I am. Now,
sending you links and everything about.
Right, exactly. Right. And so God, what he is trying to communicate is that he's going to protect us with a level of indignation to shield us from things outside of his will and his way.
Oh,
and we follow the precepts, the principles, then we stay under his protection. Here's what blows me away. Even when we stray, his mercy and grace is still able to reach us and bring us back inside of the nest, inside of the fold.
To protect
God,
us.
Right. God is not worried about nobody else. He's worried about you and me, and will go to whatever length he needs to go to make sure that you stay protected. Mind, body, soul, and spirit. That's why he sent his son to die for us.
Talk about it.
Because he's trying to protect us from the ill effects of sin. So when you read, or when somebody says, man, I wouldn't serve a jealous God, good for you, bro. I would not serve a God who is not jealous about me. My father's
who's
crazy.
Not a protector.
Hey, come on. He's crazy about me.
Crazy.
He's going to protect me. He's going to protect you. And I love it. You
know? I love it. Who would not serve who would serve a God that is not jealous?
Who would not? What are you doing? You're doing the wrong thing.
You're doing the wrong thing. You're not
that.
Serving a jealous God. You're not serving a jealous God. That means he ain't got no power. Because what is he protecting you with?
Exactly.
Exactly. I need him to have all power
exactly.
to protect me.
Exactly.
And it's because of me. I'm crazy. I'm out of control. I need all that protection.
I need it all.
I need all of it.
Exactly.
And guess what? This is the thing. I'm worth it. Listen, you are worth having a jealous God.
Absolutely.
You are worth it. That's why he goes to any length with as the pastor said, with indignation. Like he is serious and aggressive about it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
With a frowned up brow. Yes, in the Old Testament, he's going to be ugly to these people that come against you.
Come on.
Yes, let my people go.
Exactly.
Why do I have to say it more than once? Mm-hmm. Why do I? Oh, so I got to show you. Okay, I can show you better than I can tell you.
I can show you better than I can tell you. And he told him, I'm so jealous, I will visit your sins to the third and fourth generation. God don't have nothing but time.
Nothing but time.
That's the caution. That's the
right.
negative.
Yeah.
And here's what he said. I'm so jealous that I will extend righteousness to the third and fourth generation. So when you stay under that protection, you get to stay under it. Lil Mike get to stay under it. Lil Mike get to stay Woo! Under it. Lil Joe get to
Listen.
Stay under it.
Do
Lil
y'all hear? Do you see that? Do you see that? Oh my goodness.
Because his mercy endureth
forever.
Thank you for being a jealous God.
Thank you for being a jealous God. Thank you. Thank you for giving me a mind to acknowledge you as being jealous.
Amen.
And have understanding of your jealousy.
Amen.
Of your protectorship.
Amen.
Of your love for me.
Amen.
Help me to remain in the nest.
Oof. Yes.
Help me to remain under your jealousy. And not wander. And not be sidetracked or distracted. Please, God, keep me in your protection. Kana.
In your kana. He stakes his name on it.
He put his name on it.
I am provider and I'm going to create the nest, first of all. We didn't even talk about the provision. And
we didn't even get it.
I'm going to give you everything.
Jehovah Jireh. He's
right,
that.
Exactly.
Provider.
Protect you from anything that seeks to give you harm.
I don't
know if we answered your question or not, but the question that I'm still saying, why would you not serve a God?
Jealous God.
Like this.
Why? Why would you not?
Exactly.
And if this has blessed you in any way, make some comments, share it, like it. If you abhor what we've been saying, make a comment.
Exactly.
Contact us. If we didn't say it in the right way for you, make a comment, share it, like it, reach out to us. We are welcoming all of the comments.
Absolutely.
Now, don't be profane on the page.
Please.
Keep your mouth together. But say your piece. We're welcoming that.
Absolutely. Say your piece. We welcome it. We want to welcome you. Thank you
yes.
for being with us again. Tuesday yes. night theology. We have
TNT.
Explored studying God. It's been explosive. It's
yes.
been an explosion. But we came to an understanding.
We did come to an
understanding. That God is more interested in protecting us from things that seek us harm than being envious or jealous
Correct.
Of something else. It's always about us.
Always.
In his mind, it's always about us.
It's always about you.
Yep.
So you don't have to be vain. God is vain for you.
For you. You keep getting up.
That just got me, man. Listen, the Bible speaks about vain imaginations.
Absolutely.
Like self-indulgence, haughtiness, high-minded.
Mm-hmm.
God is high-minded for
you.
He's high-minded for you. Oh, man. Mm. He's high-minded for you. That's why he's jealous.
That's it.
Kana. Protector.
Protector.
He is a jealous God.
Amen.
He is a jealous God.
Amen.
And I promise you, I was a person like yourself saying, God can't be jealous.
Right.
Some of you were saying, God can't be jealous.
Right.
That don't make sense to me.
Mm-hmm.
That's my emotion.
Right, exactly.
It's you know, human that's emotion. Human. Why is that? He's not that. And then there are some that say, well, God is a jealous God. You mean God act like you? That's wrong. <Mm-mm. laughs> But he is kana. He is a protector God. Mm. I love you. God bless you. And just know that he is kana for you.
God bless you, my people.
Yes, yes. TNT.
You got to walk in that this week. He's your protector.
He is your protector. And tell somebody.
That's it.
Did you know God is jealous for you?
Mm.
There's a song by Dave Crowder Band. Maybe we'll play that for this.
He is jealous for me. Love's like a hurricane. I am a tree bending beneath the weight of his wind and mercy.
I put it in the link. He is jealous for me.
Wow.
That's the opening line.
Wow, wow.
Love's like a hurricane. And I am a tree bending beneath the weight of its wind and mercy. Wow. I'm bending beneath the weight of the wind and the mercy of God's jealousy.
Ooh, that's good.
Come on, somebody. I love y'all. We're going to go and talk more about this. We'll see y'all next Tuesday on TNT.
TNT.
Boom!